what defines a high-performing health system? And the fascinating thing as you look across the globe is that high-performing health systems are founded in effective primary care. They're not founded in disease management. They're not founded in case management, ambulatory ICUs. They're not founded in generic substitution or pharmacy benefit management. And yet these are all the interventions we see being brought to bear. They are certainly not founded in prior authorization, mother may I, and pre-existing conditions. This is not what defines a high-performing health system. So I'm looking for a way through. I want something better for us, for my patients, for me. It turns out that patients who have really good continuity, really easy access to care in terms of no waits and delays in the practice, lo and behold, their outcomes are better. All right, the problem I've got in the U.S. is that I've got a toxic policy environment. What I mean by is what I alluded to earlier, in that primary care, if we want to really screw up the country, what I do is I take effective primary care and I hobble it. I hobble it by saying, I'm going to pay you less than it takes to do the work you need, so I'm going to put you on this hamster wheel where it's impossible for you to keep up, where all you can do is basically see everybody 6 minutes, throw everything that bothers you at a specialist, and it doesn't really matter which one, just get them out of your office. And the rest of them, throw a prescription at them just so you can get on and see the next patient, because it's all about volume. It's all about, the more you do, the better. I don't really care what you do, just do a hell of a lot of it. And that's what we've got. So we've got this volume driven, and I mean, I'm talking about my own practice of old. I'm not implying anybody here is doing bad stuff. That was me, okay? This is a therapy session for me. But you get the idea that this was who I did not like to be, and then I needed to get out of that kind of system. So we've got this toxic policy environment, and we've got, as I alluded to earlier, a measurement problem in how we frame quality. If we're going to talk about becoming a high-performing health system, we've got to figure out how to eliminate these barriers, improve self-management, provide a broad array of services, and coordinate care. And as you guys should figure out, and you probably know in your gut, is that relationship is the key, and talking to people is the key. What do you need to do then, if you want in practice, to deliver phenomenal care and outcomes? And the answer is relatively straightforward. You need to know what's important, what to focus on. We can't just rely on, it's because I feel good about stuff that I know I'm doing a good job. We should have some information and feedback on that kind of stuff. We have to have supportive technology that makes it easier. The information burden of my work is huge. I love working with patients around chronic disease, around lifestyle, healthy behavior change, but the information transaction cost, back and forth with patients, phone calls, letters, postcards, come into the office, book an appointment, call a secretary, spend time. The information cost burden of that is huge. So I'm looking for ways to make that simple, and technology solves it for me. And finally, and we've worked with, at this point, thousands of practices in the IHI across the country with this. What we see absolutely consistently is that if you don't have breathing room to try something different, none of this is possible. I did a big collaborative with the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene on diabetes and depression management, worked with lots of practices from all over the city. And what we found is that practices are consistently willing to step up and say, I want to try, I want to do better, but they're unable to sustain it over time because the financing model won't support the care. And so we have this stupid financing system, and that's what's led me to this, in this room, and the practice I've got in New York, and saying, enough. What I wanted to leave you guys with was a relatively straightforward and simple example of some links. Oh, geez, went backwards. Quality and practice structure are inextricable. If you do this well, the structure of the practice makes it possible to stay on time, to see patients, to provide phenomenal communication, which is what patients are buying, so that people say, that is different. And as you know, word of mouth drives practice volume and drives practice marketing. Word of mouth of, oh my God, you won't believe what my doctor does. That's the kind of stuff that drives it. So we want that oh my God level of stuff out there. Online scheduling, communication, the secure video conferencing. I mean, I could do Skype and things like that, but I want security. I want my patients to feel this is secure, this is protected, you can get in there and see me. And I pump their stuff back to them with comments online so it's all secure. So this is what patients want. This is what they're looking for. It's possible to do this kind of stuff. The work between you and there is figuring out, okay, are you ready? Do you want to do this kind of stuff? And then reaching out and grabbing the hand of someone who's willing to help you.